Well, it started out down a dirty road. Started out all alone. I'm learning to fly, but I ain't got wings. Coming down is the hardest thing.
Just moments away from the start of a holiday weekend here at Gulfstream Park on a sultry and sunny Friday afternoon here in Hallandale Beach. In fact, late morning, shortly after 11 a.m., as we gaze out a few stories above the finish line at a fast main track and a massive turf course. And in fact, lots of grass action on the program this afternoon as we welcome you to this live Friday edition of Gulfstream Park Today. Jason Blewett once again from our third floor clubhouse studios as we do gear up for racing over the next 3 days. And with that comes a bevy of stakes races. In fact, we've got two forthcoming tomorrow afternoon, including a very history-rich carryback, which has got a very long and prestigious list of past winners to it. And we'll run a couple of races here Sunday, including a very salty Bob Humphrey Turf Sprint that has got a couple of horses, including Payne Price, going out for trainer Georgina Baxter. Now, you can't have Gulfstream Park turf racing, and thankfully there's a lot of that, without bringing in our man with the green thumb, the one and only Ron Nicoletti. Ronnie, how are things going down in that paddock set studio?
Yeah, we're ready for a nice day here. You know, we got a really nice super high five carryover starting in race number one today, if you're not aware of that. And of course, Friday, Stronic 5.
Got the Stronic 5, 150K guaranteed in the jackpot Rainbow 6. And let's not forget, again, the two stakes tomorrow, a traditional 4th of July, more or less, offering here. This would be right around in a normal year when we run the Summit of Speed, yet with COVID and everything like that, the Smile Sprint and the Princess Rooney have been pushed back a bit later this summer meet, but we do bust out the two races on the main track for the three-year-olds and the Azalea, which is featuring Bernie, who's going to be a big favorite there, and then you've got the carryback, which to me, I think Bernie, Ronnie, is a very reliable favorite and a likely winner. Carryback is a race that's got a number of different plot lines, including Kathy Ritvo's Double Crown, who's probably going to go favorite there. It has just been, boy, he's been really good in his two races for Kathy here at Gulfstream.
Yeah, I mean, everybody in those races, most of them will have to stretch out to the 7 furlongs, and that can be to tell on both those races because they haven't gone that far that fast, so we'll see how things work out. But I think you're right about Bernie in that race, even though I picked against her.
Oh, you took a shot against her, huh?
Yeah, a little bit, because of the 7 furlongs, but, you know, Bernie will be my second choice.
Okay, fair enough. That'll be tomorrow, 12 race, 4th of July, Independence Day program that begins at 12:05 Eastern or thereabouts here at Gulfstream. And as we continue to build following that Tuesday mandatory $4 million jackpot Rainbow Six pool, we've upped the ante 100K here on Wednesday. It is up to 150 large, and that'll start in race number 5, obviously midway through this 10-race Friday, July 3rd, a holiday for many, and hope it's a good start to everybody here for the holiday weekend in 2020. Now, as we move forward, we're about 55 minutes, give or take, away from that first race at about 12:05 Eastern, and with that, of course, comes a very familiar-type territory of the early pick 5. Now, it's an interesting sequence, at least putting it in a ticket like this in Ronnie Cold, a good hour and a half when I sent this ticket in before the first race, and I only say that because you've got back-to-back two-year-old races in the first, obviously on the turf, and that looks like a very solid maiden special weight cast for the two-year-old turf runners at 5 furlongs. And then in the second race, there's far more experience, but still a multi-layered two-year-old $16,000 to $14,000 maiden claimer. Now, I opted to stand alone with the Warfront Firster for Wesley Ward, who's got Pino riding, and that's the number 4, Crowley's War, in race number 1. I used a couple of second-time starters in the second race, including Gigi Conquest, the Deuce, who I like the most in that spot, along with the 7, Chucky, who's out for his third lifetime start. Three deep, three very logical. In fact, the three favorites, the only three they're probably going to bet in the third race, found their way up my ticket there. The fourth race is a two-horse spread, and hopefully closing this thing down on the turf, Ronnie, using three. Bosch is probably, and he's the three in the fifth race, he's probably the horse to beat, but I just see a real void of early speed on paper, Ronnie, and I'm hoping the two could be, we'll get an aggressive ride from Sammy Camacho. I would love to see him just grab the bull by the horns and try to wire that field as my top pick in the fifth.
Yeah, got it on my ticket, too, for those exact reasons. I think that's the speed in the field.
I hope you're right. Now, who's going to be the speed in this upcoming first race? You've got that duo for trainer Wesley Ward, including the number three Lime, who's got the virtue of being a third-time starter. Two odds on defeats to this point, but big speed in both of those races, and she ultimately might be a filly who's just going to move up on the turf. We'll see with her having the experience to date. You and I, however, both landed on the four Crowley's War in this spot, who is obviously by Warfront, big pedigree, and I do like this breeze will bring you. Now, this is two works back on the morning of June 17th for this horse who was bred in Kentucky. He's in between. Maroon Cap there. They're all blinkered up, all three of Wesley's horses. Down on the rail with the white goggles and the black and the white star and the black cap is Gem Thief. She did not run well here on Wednesday as a beaten 2-1 favorite in her debut, but as this work progresses, you will see the outside stablemate along with Crowley's War leave Gem Thief in the dust. I like this breeze, and obviously, Ronnie, I had a feeling you love Warfront. This is a big turf pedigree for this horse.
Yeah, as soon as I see Warfront, you know, I'm going to be looking at it and checking it out. I have that one on top of the ticket for all the reasons. Nice to see that breeze. But the current favorite very early in the wagering right now is the 10-horse Full Meaning, and I think that might change and the four might go favorite. This one debuting on the turf for Mike Maker. After rallying along the inside, he finished third in his 5-furlong debut on the main track. He's a son of Overdriven. He's bred to handle the surface switch, so we'll see how he runs. And as you mentioned with Lime, got that previous experience. How much does that count when they shift surfaces today?
That speed, it's not so much, I think, the experience in my mind, not that that's a hindrance, but I think it's the speed of Lime that would make her against the boys here just potentially doubly dangerous, just stylistically speaking.
Yeah, I mean, she looks like she's going to be going to the front. Journeyman Eduardo Nunez will be in the saddle.
Right, and he just doesn't get a lot of opportunity. Certainly, quote-unquote, live opportunity here. But if she's a rocket ship, it's just not that hard of a ride. You break cleanly, you get to the lead, and you just try to take them as far as you can go. So he doesn't bother me at all, and he probably has ridden her, you'd like to think, in the morning up at Palm Meadows for Wesley. Now, we stay with the two-year-olds. We'll venture over to the main track coming up on Friday 2nd on this July 3rd, 2020, with the two-year-old $16,000 to $14,000 maiden claimer. Really is, to me anyway, a battle of horses that have already notched a race or two under their respective belts, including your top pick, the 7 Chucky, who's running for the third time. And along with the experience factor, and there's just quite a bit of it to go around in this race, you've got a very important rematch off the second race here back on June 17th, which was run over a sloppy track. Your horse, Chucky, was third in that spot. My top selection, the 2, GG Conquest, was fourth. I was hoping, though, with that effort under his belt, he'd be more professional. It wasn't that he broke bad. He was just a little sluggish early and was out of the race. By the way, during a driving rainstorm, that was in what I also felt tough day to make your racing debut, Ronnie, in a torrential downpour.
Yeah, and the same thing goes with the 7 Chucky, with Juan Alvaretto, the trainer, and MCL Jaramillo, and of course GG Conquest gets Edgar Zayas, our leading rider, and Antonio Sano, and the horse that you have in second, I also had in second, Phoenician Dream, drops to this level. He was really good. He was in that good race that produced a couple of next out winners, Caramel Chip and Casalsa, which looks like that horse could be something nice.
You think so?
I think. I'm not sure. It really went well.
All right. I'm going to reserve judgment on Casala coming back and winning for maiden 50 at even money. But I hear you. No, I mean, that race, the bottom line is Venetian Dream, who didn't run a step as the favorite, is exiting a field that's already a perfect 2-for-2. And I don't know, dipping down to maiden 25 today with that effort in the rearview mirror for a guy like Larry Ravelli. He may not win today, but he's going to run a lot better, I would have to think, from post number 3. Let's move on to the third. We stay on the main. We're out in distance here with the two-lifetime 12-5 to 10-5 claiming race. And although you and I both picked against the one more than usual. I think he may be the most important a piece to the cog in this race because of his early speed, but I viewed him as a potential trap in this spot and maybe a pseudo favorite, so to speak, or co-favorite, considering I view him, even though he may get loose in this race, Ronnie, that effort two back looks good on paper, but it was a daylight win with a fast figure over a very sloppy sealed racetrack.
Yeah, I just wasn't enamored with that performance and actually backed him up a little further than you did.
What price? Were you looking at the program? What price is he on the line?
He is 5-2 on the line. Yeah. He's the morning line favorite,
yeah,
which is rightly so.
Absolutely.
I tried and get cute. I mean, with the 5 Flawless Moon like you did with Still Scheming. Still Scheming scratched out the other day to run this afternoon, but Flawless Moon stretching out to the mile again after finishing second and third respectively, going 3/4 of a mile. Sandra Marier has apprenticed Joseph Trejo's handling the added distance. Boy, that kid's been riding great. I really like the way he handles the horse. Still Scheming, I guess the one I'm going to go back and revisit this race. I just wasn't enamored with that last performance.
I just worry about him with the big win, blowout win for Safi in the slop. And I liked him last time off the claim, and he just did not run a step. May have been a slightly tougher feel, but Ultimately, I don't know how much of a difference between that 20K claiming race he's coming out of and today. And, again, thought he might be a trap, although he, again, is the most important horse in the mix. We'll see if Flawless Moon can sustain that closing kick and get the mile this afternoon. And in the case of the 7, Still Scheming, first-time KO, going from more of a low-profile to a higher-profile barn off the claim. I'll take him from the outside post. Now, we go with the cast of 5 in the 4th race, a $25,000 to $20,000 maiden claimer. And I think most, Ronnie, in this cast of 5 are going to view this as a two-horse race, win, lose, or draw, between our top pick, the 1 Rocket Blast, whose first time on the turf for Ralph Nix, and the outside horse, the number 6, extremely exclusive.
Yeah, I thought those were the logical two. Rocket Blast, son of Curlin, debuting on the turf at 5/8 after a pair of just so-so performances against Maiden Special Weight Company on the main track, going 6.5 and 8.5 furlongs respectively. Ralph Nix pretty solid with the similar class drops. We'll see how that horse runs. And extremely exclusive is dropping. I think he's owner trainer Sleep Caceres is with MSCL Jaramillo in there. Could be a good play in here because he had a rough outing last time out.
And his two turf races have been fine in a way, I think, traditional-looking turf race between just a very compact cast, and there's not a lot, even for the level established turf form. Could be a good spot for the number 6, extremely exclusive from the outside. As we take a little breather, and we'll catch up with the weather outside on a sunny Friday, we'll be back with the Rainbow 6 after this. Well, it wouldn't be 4th of July weekend here in South Florida without some top-class racing at Gulfstream Park. And the good news for us is we've got that over the next 3 days, beginning with this 10-race Friday card. Although things are quite serene and bucolic outside, the action will heat up with that walkover from the backstretch stable area at about 12:40, 12:45, or I should say 11:45, Ronnie. That's right. We start at 12:05. So there'll be action at 12:45 too, but it really starts to heat up out there with the walk over and that build up to the first race. 11:30, 11:35, give or take.
I didn't know where you were going. I thought there was somebody special coming over at 12:45. Hey, first day back. It's a long week. We got a lot of fun in front of us. Let's get it going with the Rainbow Six.
You got that right. And let's not forget, we'll give a quick reminder here to an East Coast version, that is, of the Stronach 5 with a three-pack up from Laurel Park. And we're holding down the fort here with the doubleheader.
Yeah, races 9 and 10. They are not easy, the Gulfstream races. There's lots of different ways you can go. Had a couple of scratches, so make sure you check the scratches before you put your tickets together. Three from Maryland, but I think my man Stan's got a single in that race 9 from Maryland, so maybe we can make this, we can hit this thing today.
And funny, because I did a little Diddy on the Air 40-second video that's on XB and was making the rounds, XBTV.com, and making the rounds on social media. It's a Jay Beresford Tipton. That's his single in the last race today in the Stronach 5.
The $1 million guy.
That, exactly, and that was story time. I think if I remember correctly, Grandma Nicoletti used to like that show.
It was unbelievable. He gave the people $1 million, but they couldn't screw up, or they had to give the million back.
Well, you'd have to give the million back. I'd probably have to do that, too, certainly with the rejoiner a few minutes back there. But it's all good, my friend. Let's chase the $1.50 guaranteed in the Jackpot Rainbow Six. We're on the turf, pretty competitive turf race in this opening leg. I highly doubt, although you had told me the two could be is on your ticket, on your play, I would highly doubt you singled here, right, to start?
No, but he is my long shot in the afternoon, so we're thinking alike with that one. But I also used Basha, who you mentioned, I thought was the one to beat in there, along with Cash Call Kitten. And three deep in race number six there. I like French Quarter this afternoon, but I did put Are You Lucky on top, but I couldn't leave French Quarter off the ticket, and I used Assertico in there, too. And you got a stat on Chaffee in that race that will show you. Two deep in race number seven. I think those are the logical two with Grand Nanuco and Tipsy Kitten. Three deep in race number eight, Uncle Andrew, Blazing Desire, and Keepsake Kitten. And then two deep in the final two races, Alizé, Sammy Sunshine. And I like Joe Benjamin in the last race a little bit, but I use Fake Muse too. So a couple of different angles for me. 43-20 with that $150,000 jackpot guarantee.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I miss Joe Benjamin. I don't have him 1 through 4. And just prepping for the show this morning, I said, not that I love him in that race, but he's a player, and he may catch a feel, maybe not all that much tougher than the maiden claimers he's been running with, and he's got speed. No, he's a major player, and upon looking at this card again, he's a horse fairly late in the day. In fact, in the finale, might have missed to an extent, but we'll talk about that race in a few minutes, my friend. Let's get through this upcoming fifth race, where although I like the two could be and took this horse on top, as did you, just hoping Sammy Camacho would dare to be great, send him to the lead, and just try to bottom out this field. That could be a great tactic. He's not the horse to beat, though. I think that moniker goes right next door to the three Basha, who in a race like this has got some good looking races on the go back, and I don't know if he's ever run this low for the 12.5.
Yeah, he's dropping to that level today. If they're facing considerably tougher throughout, his 15 race turf campaign, Jenna Antonucci has Edgar Zayas. He's a 6-year-old son of Uncle Mo, and he's been good. He's been bad. He's dropping way down. He's never run for 12.5. So we'll see how he's going. I think that they got to use the speed in here. So I went with Could Be on top of the ticket with Sammy Camacho. I think the horse is the controlling speed. And I know you have Cash Call Kitten along with me, who's wheeling back today.
Who's coming out of, as far as stock in just in a vacuum, give me the strongest last out effort. For me anyway, I don't think it's debatable. I think it belongs to the 8, Cash Call Kitten, and will revert back to this horse's most recent start. What concerns me, it's not the quality or strength of this performance for Joe Orsino and Amis Sayel, where this horse, by the way, the 9, we had him highlighted in the light blue, the turquoise saddle towel, made tough to win at this point. I know they just turned up the backstretch, but he has no position whatsoever. He's parked now, 4 wide, 5 wide, and you'll see Amis Sayel going, I got to go after this Sharmell Shake, who's just laying and walking the dog on the front end. And I think Amis Sayel did and dealt with the hand that he was forced. But this early run, not an easy way to get it done on the turf. So good effort with a pretty taxing Very, very much a ground loss type wide trip. But what concerns me, Ronnie, about him, it's not, again, it's not this effort by itself. It's just the fact that he normally, this horse, Cash Call Kitten, puts himself behind the eight ball. And how much speed is he going to get in this race?
He's not going to get a lot of speed to help him out. That's why I had him further down the ticket. But you're right, he flattened out a little bit after making that big, huge run. He's going to break from the outside today so he can see the speed to his inside. So if someone goes up and challenges, could be early on, might set up for him Cash Call Kitten. And Basha, for the reasons we mentioned, just the old class horse dropping way down this afternoon.
Yeah, dangerous for 12-5. Now, it's not a case of horses dipping down in class in race six today as we chase that Friday, July 3rd. Late pick five, and a play for me using the two horses that have already walked the walk and talked the talk, and they've done it, most importantly, at this 1 mile trip. And I think that is the real line in the sand, so to speak, between a couple of horses like Assertico stretching out in good form, and Safi's runner, the 7 Are You Lucky, stretching out in good form. Can they stay the mile trip? I'm going to go to horses that have already done it in the past, and I'm too deep to start. I've got coverage in race 7 this afternoon, where the horse to beat, I think, is the 3 Grand Anuco. We'll talk about him in a few seconds. I've got another 3-horse spread in the 8th race. There was one massive scratch on today's card, Ronnie. Not many changes, and we'll catch up with Pete, say, in less than 10 minutes from now for the opening set of the Friday scratches and changes. But that 9th race, losing the number 5, Lil Miss Hotshot. I had picked her on top. Did you like her there?
I had her second behind Alize. I actually had Alize on top of my ticket, but did have her on the ticket for sure. That's what I was mentioning with the Stronic Fight. I said there's a couple of scratches in our final two races that you have to check.
Want to give some props. He's probably not the horse to beat. I don't know if you get as high as 8-1, but I wanted to give a little bit of love here and some acknowledgement to the 3 French Quarter, who's obviously one of 2 I have, and have him second, in fact. Again, I prefer the horses that have routed successfully in the past. And for French Quarter, although he's coming out of a race against the low level or the bottom level claimers for $6,250, I mean, you'd be hard-pressed to find a grittier, honest, more resilient type 9-year-old gelding who's 14-11-6, from 66. I mean, this horse is the antithesis of a thoroughbred that does not have a glass jaw. He hits hard, and he's been good for just about everybody that's ever thrown the tack on him. He's a pleasure. He really is a pleasure to watch run. He's one of my favorite horses currently racing in South Florida.
Yeah, and he's a 1 mile specialist, 3-4 at the distance. You know, rides, as you mentioned, that 14-time winner. I did go with Are You Lucky, who's dropping to the 16 level today and debuting at a mile after returning from the layoff to defeat those 35 claimers as the odds-on choice. So I looked up a stat on Sappy Joseph Jr. This is with horses going from a sprint to a route who were a winner last time out on the dirt. He's 7-9, 78%, 78% in the money, and a $3.84 return of investment. I was pretty shocked when I found that stat.
That's an outrageous, outrageously
that's what
big
a winner
number.
Last time. Yeah, I was saying, holy mackerel, so I had to put that out there, and that's over the last 5 years. A lot of that stat was actually in the last 2 or 3 years, but I put the whole 5 years, mm-hmm. because a couple did win a little further back.
No, it's a big, big-time move for a trainer that's made a lot of good moves here over the last 24 or 36 months. We'll see. I'm wondering how far, even with the good stat, Are You Lucky might want to run, considering this horse has not been beyond 6.5 furlongs, but he did win 3 back by 10. We'll see with him from the outside. Crammy Boy, who I went to on top, has a similar look to him as French Quarter. At first glance, you might go, well, they maybe look a notch or two below this field, but I do like a horse that has refound himself, maybe not the most consistent in the world, but he's refound himself for Peter Walder, and more often than he's been good rather than just being average or bad, and I like the recent form of the 4 Crammy Boy, who, like French Quarter, can stay the trip. Then you've got Assertico, who's riding a pretty big figure victory last time out. Can he, along with Are You Lucky, can he stretch that talent of his, because he's good, can he do it around a 1-turn, 8-furlong trip?
Yeah, he's the other one trying run the mile this afternoon after back-to-back sprint victories going three quarters. Ronnie Spatz got the apprentice negotiating that added distance, so getting a little break in the weight, so we'll see how that horse runs. But I just couldn't believe that stat I found on the number seven. We'll see if it comes to fruition in there. But you made a good move by taking horses that are proven at that mile distance.
Yeah, that was my game plan for the seventh, right or wrong. We'll move on to race number seven now, or that was my plan for race six. We'll move on to the seventh, which is a 12-5 dated claimer for horses that have not won a race since January 3rd of 2020 on the turf here. Race we already brought you, that Sharm El Sheikh Cash Call Kitten race. We'll bring it back once again, and you've got two very important players coming out of the first race here back on June the 12th. Now, Tipsy Kitten's in the field. He's the sixth. The horse you really want to watch, at least as far as the first quarter mile is concerned, is the number 12, Son of a Wahoo, who went off at 50-1 in this race. He was park wide, where Tipsy Kitten had more of a trip slanted towards a traditional turf trip, where he's saving at least a little more ground and covered up a path and a half off the rail. Not the case for the 12, Son of a Wahoo, who basically had to endure a very similar type running line and trip to Cash Call Kitten, where they were hopelessly wide. Now, at this point, Son of a Wahoo is really taking the overland route, and you can see, though, the six Tipsy Kitten, Ronnie, he's saving ground, but where's he going to go from there? He's got a really knife and fiddle his way through between horses, and in the end, he'll run a pretty solid race after angling out. Saved ground through much of this two-turn turf route. He did angle out and finished up with a good amount of run with trainer David Fox.
Yeah, and that's why I went to him. You know, he moved to David Fox Barn via the claim after he was waiting for, you know, racing room, as you saw there when finishing second. He closed well. But what I liked about this horse, if you go back, the gelding has shown in the past that he can win from a stalking position. I think he's going to be closer. My thought was he's going to be closer to the pace this afternoon if he gets that clean trip. So he's not one of these horses you say, oh, my God, he needs the big pace in front of him to run. I think he's got the tactic ability to be a little closer, and that's why I put him on top of my ticket.
Now, that will be a great tactic to have, at least theoretically speaking, because when you draw this race up, it's not all that dissimilar to the Cash Call Kitten race we had talked about, and a spot both of us took could be, hoping he'd be the speed, because in looking at this cast, you couldn't draw things up on paper. As far as the blueprint goes, in regards to the three Grand Nanuko, who may get everything his own way. So if Tipsy Kitten is able to basically latch on to him and not be victimized if it's a slow pace, well, that should work out quite nice for him. On the flip side of all that, though, Grand Nanuko by himself is just a major, major player. And you'd like to think coming into this thing, he has only run once basically since last Halloween, and that effort back in the middle of June, on June 13th, was good enough that he might be able to be just a little sharper, wouldn't you say, this afternoon with that race under his belt?
Absolutely, and he's stretching out to one of his favorite distance of a mile in the 16th. He's a three-time winner from eight starts. He returned. That's a seven-month layoff to prompt the pace, and it was a slow pace that day. He finished third against 12-5 open claimers. This is a dated claiming race. I think it's a good spot, and I think he's the one to beat for Francisco D'Angelo. Lionel Reyes in the saddle today, and you showed why Son of a Wahoo is on my ticket. He's eligible certainly to take a positive step forward from a much-improved post this afternoon.
Three-year-old claimers in the meantime are on the grass for Friday's 8th as we move fairly late and deep into the program here at Gulfstream. It's a 12,500 to 10-5 claiming race, and a race to me that distilled very much in the camp of the three you and I, most importantly the three you and I have boxed up. In fact, we both took the number 8 Uncle Andrew on top for Mike Maker, but you've also, and I think again distilling this race down to those three horses, the one common trait is they've all been recent claims for the most part, where Safi's got the reclaim of the six Keepsake Kitten off a layoff and a dip in for 10-5. Maker claimed the 8 horse for us, Uncle Andrew, two starts back. And then you've got Blazing Desire on the outside, who's a former Maker runner in off a slim victory, now with trainer Amador Sanchez. What's the stat you've got with Amador?
Well, Amador had it updated. I had done it on Sunday, had to redo it again today because he had another first-time winner. So first after the claim, all levels, he's now 4 for 11, 36%, 45% in the money, 281 is the return of investment. That's in the past 90 days because I just keep saying, hey, he claimed that horse and it won. You know, so I had to look at the stat, and I had, as I said, I'd done it on Sunday, but I had to redo it, not on Sunday, on the last day we were here.
No, it would have been Tuesday, and then you probably had to do it, redo it Wednesday because he had that that Kozan filly who got bet and won again.
No, I did it. That, no, now I know. I did it on Wednesday, and I redid it today because that's what
Oh, that was the horse that upped it, right?
For some reason, I thought it was Sunday the other day. Excuse us for that.
Well, it's been it's been a weird week here with racing on Tuesday and Wednesday, but it's all good. We can agree and confirm it's Friday, July 3rd.
Right.
No, that is a barn, and I've noticed with All Gorilla, who won here Tuesday. Yeah, won June 30th. I think it was the first or second race. That horse got bet into the teeth. It was the second race. There was a Maker Ramsey drop down. All Gorilla got bet for Amador, went to the lead, never looked back. Day after, you had the Kozan filly who upped that stat just showed. Yeah. She got bet, never had an anxious moment. Now, that's a barn whose horses have been very live on the tote board and have been running to that strong tote support. But that's usually the case, meanwhile, with the 8 Uncle Andrew, who just makes a lot of sense here.
Yeah, he looks, you know, we both have him on top of the ticket for all those reasons. You know, dropping to the 12-5 level, debuting locally for Mike Makey, finished second against those 16 claimers at this one-mile distance. Sammy Camacho in the saddle. Thought he was the logical one, but good stat on Amador Sanchez.
And then we move on to the ninth. Again, this was the race, at least in my eyes, that had hands down easily the biggest defection, early defection on the card with the absence, the early scratch of the 5, Little Miss Hotshot. We'll catch up with Pete in a couple of races from now. With her out, I scratch into the 4, Sky Chaser, whose recent form has been pretty good. I think Crumbun, who beat her last time out, I think she's coming back as an MTO. She might be an MTO here Sunday afternoon in one of those turf stakes for trainer Larry Bates. I've got her on top with the Gustavo Delgado, the OG in the house here, Gustavo with the 8 Free to Fly, who, I mean, this is an operation that's been claiming and moving horses up over the last year or so. And you obviously prefer the, speaking of a trainer change, the ex-Navarro runner, who's now with Elizabeth Dobles and the number 2, Alize.
Yeah, Mark Valesky, this daughter of Mark Valesky, makes her first start. She survived the stretch still to defeat those 42 lifetime claimers. That was going to mile 16. It was joined during January, so I looked up just a straight-out trainer switch with Elizabeth Dobles. Over the last 2 years, she's 5-26, 19%, 35% in the money, and a 2.92 return of investment. And I did, I think, with the scratch of the, you know, of the what we call horse in here, I just thought that changed the whole race around. In this one, I had on top of my ticket all along with the scratch of Little Miss Hotshot.
Now, the 10th, my friend, will hit double digits at about 4:30 this afternoon, and this will be final call. And we do end the card on this Friday, July 3rd in style. It's a good little maiden special weight. It's a weird race because you've got a couple of first-time starters, obviously from the rail, the one spin factor, who I have second, debuting for Edgard and Mike Maker. Not a Ramsey homebred, by the way, by Hard Spun, but that horse is in the mix. Mark Cassie's got a firster by Tisnow and the 8 Unbridled Tizzy. And then you've got the Wesley Ward, somewhat later debuting, number 10 horse Sallow, who's got a fast work tab. It's a real mishmash of horses. We've also got trainer Kelsey Danner, who's sending out your third selection of my top pick in the 9, Mr. Matashek, who's a colt by More Than Ready. Going back to this horse's last start, ran fine to me. This is a couple weeks before Halloween, so it was a long time ago, but you try to keep your eye. It's a little, not jarring, Ronnie, but just, I guess, not having Keeneland this past April, watching a race turning for home, I had almost lost this horse, but he's about to split. He's got that little white diamond on his face, green cap. He'll slide through down inside, and I guess my point in showing this, not that he ran outstandingly awesome, but he ran well enough going long on the turf. Coming back, layoff aside, now in good hands with Kelsey Danner. He's just, isn't he a major player today, Ronnie?
Yeah, that was a pretty nice performance for him against some really tough customers, and that was when he went in the Wesley Ward barn, so now in Kelsey Danner's barn. But I did go with the 6, Joe Benjamin, who's stepping up to face these maiden special weight runners with the speed needed, I think, to dictate the pace. And, of course, there's certainly you want to have some kind of speed on it. Murat Sankal, MSC El Jaramillo, it's a son of Hard Spun. And I use Fake Muse on my ticket, too, who departs from the tough outside post. And he's got some speed, too, in there. I think he'd be okay in there. Now, I lost to four Money.
That I think was it's Money who's running Sunday for Ward and the Zayats.
Yeah. And that Money was my second choice, so I bumped the 11 up Fake Muse. But now that I saw that replay from Keeneland, I'm going to use Mr. Matuchek a little higher. I thought it was Matuchek. The guy that used to play football, Matuzak.
Right. Who I think has passed on, right?
Yeah, Matuzak. Yeah, he passed away.
All right. Well, we're glad you're with us. We're glad everybody's with us today, my friend. We've got a fast and firm July 3rd Friday here waiting in the wings. And before we go any further, Ronnie and I, of course, with you all day long, about 10 minutes before the first. And we'll have the big man upstairs, Pete Aiello, up next with those scratches and changes.